Call the regular meeting to order for October 7th, 2014. Sister Catherine, you give the opening blessing.
God our Father, as we come to you at the end of this day, we just ask that you bring quiet to our minds and hearts, peace within us, and especially that you bring your words of quiet and peace and harmony to our minds and to our hearts. Let every word that we speak originate from you, every thought that we think truly be the words and the thoughts that you would think, so that all of our actions and all of our undertakings may truly give you praise and glory. With this prayer and to all prayer, we say, amen.
Additions to the agenda besides discussion on the scout cabin repair?
I do have the appropriation that's listed on your agenda there. It is an addition that I didn't have on the original agenda.
Put that scout cabin under old business. Any others? Move to approve.
So moved.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Citizens comment, Sydney Wynn with Health Communities at Net.
Hi. I just thought I wanted to come in and give you an update on the Health and Communities Initiative. And as a refresher, it's a 4-year grant through the Kansas Health Foundation to help promote active living and healthy eating in our community. We are on year 2 of the grant. This year, they have given us extra money to be used specifically for consultation and technical assistance purposes to help with our initiative. After talking with the Healthy Communities Leadership Team, which represents the county, so we have people from Maxville, St. John, and Stafford, we would like to use the funds for PedNet. PedNet is an organization solely that promotes active living and active transportation. They've helped a lot of communities in Kansas develop a master walk bike plan. They are very knowledgeable. With their help, we would be able to come up with a plan specifically for the Dollar General route. So that would be First Street from Dollar General to Santa Fe, and then down Third to down Main, if that makes sense, all the way to the 9th Street to the park. We would just plan that out, and then from that we would have a blueprint. So just an idea of what it would look like once we made some active transportation changes, and then cost estimates. And that way, as a community and as a council, we could just look at it and think what would fit within our budget, you know, at our own pace, and just take what we like and just see if we like something and what the changes would be. Here's an example. This is a brochure of what they did, and I'll let you guys pass it around, but they have pictures of currently what different places looked like before and then their changes, including the path. And that's kind of what this would be. We would have a map. The end result of this plan would be a map showing the community what the changes would look like in the future. And then this just shows the different projects that a certain city set aside, showing their phase one, when they have the money, they're going to do project one and project two. And that's kind of an idea of what it would look like. I just wanted to let you know what we are doing. Our funds will be covering this, so nothing for you guys. He will actually be in next week, early next week. I have to look to make sure. I think it's Monday or Tuesday. So if you guys want to meet with him and discuss with him and get a better understanding of active transportation, we can set up a meeting with him as well.
Okay, is that an architect or engineer?
Just both. He's going to be designing and working with his consultant.
Okay.
And I came here to let you know because we would just want your support in this as well before we move forward.
Any Thank you. The consent agenda, approve the minutes for the regular meeting, 9/16/2014. Approve appropriation ordinance, 10/1/2014, the amount of $11,747.26. Solid waste, $11,747.26. Approved appropriation ordinance 10/7/2014, the amount of $147,082.02, as stated. I hear motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. So. All those opposed. Okay. Carl Miller, pictometry.
Mr. Bell.
Yes, sir.
Unless you have anything to put
on. Yep. Okay.
I got it.
Clip in?
Yeah.
Nope.
I'll take it
on the other end.
I think I'm okay.
You're going to
show us something on.
Well, I didn't know what you guys wanted to see a little bit.
Yes.
Thank
you.
I got a packet for everybody here. This is on
I'm good.
What this here is this is pictometry, and what this is we were trying to find out here a while back where the community is on aerial photography and how interested the county is and how interested the cities are. So we got a hold of pictometry. Our photography right now, if I click on this, put it down here. And right now, the city does use our maps and stuff. I mean, we talk quite a bit, mostly because
for zoning
and so forth like that. This is going to be our photography right here. With the blue line, that's the building we're in right now. And when we're talking about photography, this is what everybody currently has, except for a handful of counties that went over to pictometry. The difference with pictometry is, if you notice, you're looking at the top of the building, which is called ortho. So you're gonna look down straight on top of the building and you have no other view. Google, you can do a satellite, you can get down on the street, or get into Google here in a little bit. But, because Google is good and we use Google. But if you look at the very first handout that I gave you, what this here is, does anybody want? Okay. Where you can see up in that little photo right there, what pictometry does is it puts six more cameras on the airplane and it gives you a view of every part of the structures as they're flying. So you're not only going to see the top, you can see the sides of the structure. And that's important for when we get into the next thing, but I wanted you to at least know what pictometry does compared to normal photography. It's going to give you a different angle is what it does. Okay? So on the next pages, they're stapled together. These are a handful of things that each entity kind of goes through. I highlighted the GIS mapping because that's what we would use in the appraiser's office. This is where it would help us in the appraiser's office. To overlay shape files and geo-reference data directly over the images. Measure the distance, height, area of everything that you see. Annotate text, lines, circles. You can, what that means, you can name everything that you want to. Obtain geo-coordinates from every pixel. And a pixel is each photo. As you get in closer to the photography, there's a pixel. And so you click on that, it actually, pictometry will give you the longitude and latitude on there. We don't have that right now. We've got pretty much the plans you can get on there. provide your data to a wider audience and so forth. But what we would use is where you get down to the cities and so forth, you can kind of go through here, and if you have a fire, the fire department. What we would like, though, is the reason I've been meeting with the cities in counties is we would like everybody to use pictometry as a tool to save your man hours and help your city. And what I mean by how you can help your city is you can make different layers of information, and it's pretty well infinite. If I turn this here layer off, you would see where the photography would go away, because photography is a layer. Or I could turn that back on, and I could turn off the property lines. That's a layer. If the cities wanted to do a layer for manholes, if the city wanted to do a layer for fire hydrants, if the city wanted to do their water line, you know, whatever, it's kind of an infinite type thing. If the more you want to use it, that would be a layer. And so you turn them on and turn them off, whatever you need to do. Some of the communities that use pictometry, they use, the fire department uses it because you can see that photo. The police departments use it because as we get in here, you're going to be able to see every access to that structure. Is that important to me? No, it's not. But it's important to police departments and so forth, especially if Great Bend was coming to St. John to do something to help. Like when Ellsworth downtown was burning, Great Bend's big truck went up there. They could have had a photography. They could have seen what the building looked like and the buildings around it, what they had to do and how they were going to fight that fire when they got there. That's why we want everybody to use it. Otherwise, it's going to be a really nice toy. But we're going to use it every day in the appraisal office. So instead of boring you with a lot of reading there, you guys can read that later, and if you want to get it to your fire chief or police department, they can see what they use it for also. What I'm going to do now, I'll turn this around just for a little bit. Now this, what I showed you, that intertwines with the appraisers, our information on every property record. I can jump to the aerial and so forth like that, and that's linked with our appraisal system. Now what I'm going to do is, we have a temporary assignment for Saline County and for Riley County. This is Brookville right here. Everybody kind of visualize Brookville in their head in Saline County on Old Highway 40. Now this would be pictometry here. And what I'm going to do, can you see that okay or not? Is I'll click here and we're going to zoom in a little bit here. And this would be the quality that you guys would get for your city. This is 9-inch photography. What we have at the county is 36-inch. And this is what it would look like. If we go down here, that's what you see on ours. You're seeing the rooftops. Is all you can see. That would be the only option that we have. With pictometry, now what this is this is a web-based pictometry system. And what I mean by that is if you guys wanted to join in the city, and if Mel had a tablet or something out in the city, he could pull up pictometry wherever he's at, as long as he has the internet. Which may help you, may not. It helps me considerably when I'm out in the county and so forth, where I can look at stuff. Now we don't have pictometry yet, but I'm going to use it all the time. And you can see this is. Do I need to zoom that out? Okay. Everybody. Now what's different here is, remember, we were just looking down. If you see these little arrows here, it'll flip it around. And it will go to the other side. If you want to zoom in from that point, then he can zoom in. If he's looking for a certain area, you can zoom in pretty close. What's nice about this also is, if you need to do something for a measurement, or say for a truck, for a fire hydrant or something, you can measure with these tools up here, and he can come here and he can go across and measure the distance on there. Law enforcement, because it has every photo now has a date on it. And you know, if you go to court, those photos have to have dates on them when that photography was flown. That was very important. Every photo that you would print will have a date on it of when it was flown. There could be different times, because as the plane flies, you're going to go here and then you're going to come back and forth. So the time could be different depending if you're higher level, what have you. But you still get the ortho from that. If I would go over to Slina bought the 3-inch. And the 3-inch, you can read a lot of the signs. But the 3-inch gets a little expensive. And that's why we thought going 9-inch for the cities here. And then maybe later, if we want to refly 5, 6, 7 years down the road, if the cities want to go to the 3-inch, and they see that everybody, all the entities are using it, it would be more usable friendly then. And the reason I'm saying 9-inch is, you guys don't know how much you're going to use it. The cities don't. So why go spend extra money on 3-inch photography when 9-inch is already 3 times closer than what we have already? And you can go a little closer here. It's kind of hard one.
Not at your desk, right?
Yeah. But from here then, if you wanted to see that side there, you would flip that over and you could see there. And then if you needed to zoom in, you would go to that. If it came to the point to where you needed to see, measure the height of a building or measure a distance, then that's all done here on there. So you just have to remember, though, it is photography and it's not live. Somebody asked me, well, isn't this getting into your personal stuff? Remember, it's a photo on there.
No drones flying.
No drones are flying. No drones are flying. On that.
So even on the 9-inch, if you wanted to zoom in close enough to see, like, fire poles or even water meters, you'd be able to. Even on a 9-inch, would you be able to zoom in to do that?
A 9-inch, you wouldn't see the meters.
Or not the meters, but the water
the
holes.
It probably,
fire hydrants and poles.
He could probably find them quicker because he knows where they're at. Where I might have to skim through them or find out what some cities are going to do in the other counties. And Stafford City talked about it, is right now we're thinking about flying in March because we don't want the leaf on. We want leaf off. Now Google's maps are pretty because they're leaf on, you know, and all that's pretty and so forth. But we're not worried about pretty. We're worried about making good maps for what we need to do. And so they would fly leaf off, so it won't be pretty. It'll be clear though. So to answer your question, some cities are going to go out and paint a white X on them, and then when they fly over, then they'll see the white X's. That takes care of that part of it.
So you could do that
with
the manholes
as
well?
Yeah, I talked to Carl about that. Like a lot of our manholes may be in an alley or the dirt road going out to the sewer ponds or something like that. They're always covered up with dirt.
Well, I was just thinking, you know, Jeff was talking about trying to make a map for the poles and all that. That would be this.
The 3-inch is really good. But the 9-inch, you can still... Can I just turn this around for a minute? Let me see if I can find it.
Carl, when you say we could turn it off and on, a layer off, does that mean we would have access to actually doing that ourselves?
That's something we were going to talk about.
Oh, okay.
It all depends how aggressive you want to be. You can see there. You can see it
right
there. And so if you kind of knew where they were, and if he wanted to zoom in on that, it would get a little more distorted. But if he knew where they were, he can actually measure the height of those. And what you ask is kind of ironic, because some of the bigger cities, what they're also doing is they're using pictometry to do future budgets, like on replacing things, mm-hmm. and then they're color coding that area of their city, or if they go back and they fix a new valve somewhere. If their water lines are red, they might put a blue for that's just been repaired, and then you can name it repaired 2014 or replace new or something of that nature. And then that can be a layer though. You don't want to make a layer for every manhole, you want a layer for all the manholes.
So you can edit on top of your layer.
That's correct.
Okay.
Now what she was talking about is who has the authority to do this? Now some cities don't want to make a layer. Okay, they're going to have us do it, or the appraiser's office. How that is there will be multiple licenses for this with passwords. And so, like here, if you wanted to make a layer, you could make your layer, use Mel's information, and you guys can get everything good and looking nice. And then you would not ship it, though, to Pictometry. You would do a shape file and send it to Maryland. Maryland would load it in on the with the property line, and then we would send it off to Pictometry. And Pictometry, they have two big servers, one's in Rochester and one's in Montana. And so if one goes down, they have the other one right away. So they're really, what's nice about this is they really are our IT people, that we don't have to be experts on all of this. We just have to kind of know how to do a lot of it. And if we needed help, then we can get some help.
So there is support.
There's support, yes.
Would that be she does that, loads it to Maryland, and then there, is that like a 1 day or 2 day?
Probably a 3 day. And then what's nice about that is, and the city of Larned had a concern, because we're gonna talk about Google, but who you want to see your infrastructure. You know, you might not want everybody to see your water lines, because you might not want, but remember, it's a password oriented. If even though we're on a web-based system, sorry, but everybody can't get in it. And just when I signed in here today, I had to sign in with the password. If you don't have that password, you cannot get in there.
But it is a good concern.
There's always
smart enough to get in there.
I thought it was good. Yeah. And what Lane was even talking about, you guys know Lane Mason Massey? Mm-hmm. What he was even talking about is if, and I haven't got the answer back, is if he wanted to send us in the appraiser's office his more of confidential information, could we just load it and not send it? And then everybody could still see it. That way Pictometry wouldn't even see it. It would just be seen here. And I don't have an answer for that.
And where would that back up?
That's what I'm waiting on the answer for. Yeah.
Well, so truly these, you'd want it just on a disk or something, wouldn't you?
Well,
or a USB.
But your county, it backs up off-site, doesn't it?
That's correct.
So would that be part of your whole...
Well, what we would probably do is you would probably put it on a disk. Whatever you don't want nobody to see, you'd make your layer, and then you would make your disk, and then you would make your disk on your computer. That's kind of foreseeing how I can see this is going to happen.
Now, gathering all the information isn't going to happen in 3 days, though.
Now,
just wanted to make that clear.
Now, and we talked about this, and I don't think, you know, because you're workload, I don't think you need to. What we're going to try to do is make our layers as time permits. We're going to put on what we have. And what we're giving the cities already is the center lines, of course, you're going to get the aerial photography, and you're going to get the property lines. You don't have to maintain the property lines with partial split or anything of that nature. We'll do all that. And then when we send that up, then you'll see all the splits and combinations or what have you. So that you don't have to maintain that. That's a given there.
Will there be addresses with that?
There'll be streets.
But with the property lines, so we'll have lot numbers, or, I mean, how are we going to identify?
Identify them with those parcels. It should have the addresses of what you're going to have on there. And then that would be something we would work with you on, because you know your addresses better than anybody.
We call you guys.
Yeah. Okay. But anyway, so that's so if we go to this here page, and I'm kind of going through this because I know you guys got a busy night, to this here page, and we have three of them on the back, and some of them might be right on the back or some of them would be like that, yeah. That's our county, and originally, pictometry in the green, they had St. John and Maxville going at 3 inch. So if you look at the page before that, I have a couple things, one line highlighted, and then the word no in red. The 3 inch, nobody's gonna do, unless you guys want to, I can get another bid then. Nobody in Stafford County was gonna do the 3 inch, but everybody was gonna do the 9 inch, and that's what that cost is, around $52,402, okay? So what that says though, is each one of those are done in sectors. That map that you see on the back, that's, they fly in sectors. So if I break that down per city, because all three cities are about the same size except for Hudson's, Radium, and Seward, it would cost you guys approximately $4,500 for the first 3 years. So what that means is, and pictometry is gonna let the entities pay in a 3 year period. And how this would work is, the county will have the contract with pictometry. Okay, so the county will actually write pictometry the fund, the money. When we sign the contract, and then we have 1, 2, 3 year term. Okay, so we thought we could do the same with the cities. And what that would do is that would break down for the first 3 years when the photography is paid for. It would cost about $1,300 to $1,500 a year. And then after the third year, so it would be the fourth year, that would drop to about $600. And what that does is that would help the county, that would help, each city would help with the IT maintenance part, but it also, because every time I think the city wants a layer, there's no sense having a check going back and forth, or if the city wants a map or something. So what I tried to do is I put in there like one layer a year. Because if you guys are as busy as we are, that's about all the time you're gonna have, depending on how busy you are, unless you go hire somebody. Because that would take that care of that, but that would kind of take into account for all that from then on then. So that would be the cost. The county's cost would be about $43,500. And they would pay that in the 3 year period on that. And then we would pay part of the maintenance and so forth like that. Now one thing that we would do is with pictometry, we do get a hard drive. Okay? And we would probably keep that at one of the banks or somewhere or offsite or out of the county. And maybe we'll keep Pawnee County's over here and put St. Stafford County's over there or something of that nature. The reason I mention other counties is, if you noticed on those on this here, we're actually getting a discount right there. And we're going to get another 5% discount. These figures could actually drop a little bit if the city of Great Bend comes into play. Because once they're going to give another 5%. Because right now, Pawnee County and their cities, and Ellsworth County and their cities are participating. Stafford, so we got that 15% discount if all three are going. So for getting the best photography, and I think probably everybody here thought this was going to be crazy expensive, I think it's manageable for the county and for the cities to go from what I showed you first at plain with kind of work while we're working with, and that photography is 2006, or we can jump way ahead and we can be right here with everybody, you know, with the big entities and not pay a lot of money.
So the county has approved this yet?
I'm gonna take the final to them next Wednesday. They're going to Garden City tomorrow, and we're gonna look and we're gonna see if they're gonna sign it.
So if, say we don't wanna do this,
okay.
If the county does go ahead and do it.
That's a good question. Well,
we're going to charge us for everything anyway. We're going to end up paying that one way or the other.
Well, we have to.
Well, I understand that. I didn't say.
Yeah. What we won't do, though, what we won't do is send these funds to the taxpayers. If you guys or people come in and they want your map for your property, they still get it free. They pay taxes.
Right.
So that won't change. that's how we feel. They shouldn't, they already pay them. So they've already paid for it once.
Right.
So now if you come in, Mel comes in to get my property, then he would pay a little bit of the printing. But if he comes in to get his, then that's free.
Right.
Can you print off anything in your office there? In other words, can Maryland pull something up over there and say, we want a hard copy of this? Is there any way we can do that?
And actually, part of that price that I build in, so we don't send the city a bill for $100, $200, whatever, that's built in on accident too.
Okay.
So what that would do is we can't print that big, but we can go 42 inch by 42 inch, which I think that's probably 36 by 36. We can go quite a bit bigger than that yet, but we can't go that big.
So if we had a layer, in other words, a manhole if we wanted, we would do that.
Okay. And what you might want to do is if you was going to work in a certain part of the city, because it's web-based, you can print it off on a piece of paper
right. And
go out. And then when you're done and we send that off, then you're going to say, now we want a big map to hang or to put in a fireproof. Then we're printing.
Can he say he had a pad with him? Can he go and physically, as he kind of like a GPS deal, can he physically mark on that as he's, you know, instead of trying to go back and find it, I'm here, so I mark it, we put a new valve here or whatever?
He won't be able to do it, she'll have to do the layer. He won't be able to do the layer, but he can pinpoint him, and then he'll probably want to do that back here anyway.
Okay.
On there. And he can measure across and what have you, or she, or whatever.
But when he's actually there, can he get his coordinates and everything?
He can actually go on, and he can do the pixel, and he can get the longitude and latitude of that specific spot. He can zoom in. It would get ugly. The photography would, because we'd be too close. But he would get that. He would get that spot. And you can do that with anything. There were some questions. I'm gonna pick up your stuff. On the next page, where I have some things highlighted, that is some. You guys probably talked about that. The NG911. Have you guys talked about that? That aerial photography.
Okay.
What that is the state of Kansas did fly. Earlier in the year, because actually when I got this information, we thought about doing away with pictometry and just using this. This is new photography. It's flowing at 1 foot. We're going to fly at 9 inch. So this is even closer yet. The difference with this is, remember, it's going to be straight down, and you can't measure off of it. So if he wanted to make layers, and it's not web-based, he would have to give us everything, and then we would do it whenever we had time. It's going to be good as a comparison to use the free photography. Now, we have requested it already. We're already running through red tape to get it. So we're supposed to get it sometime, but as of right now, nobody has it. So, on there. And then on the very last thing, and this is where I sat down because the city of Larner had questions about Google compared to pictometry. You can go buy Google Pro, I think it is that right? Google Earth Pro, and you can actually measure off of it. You can do a lot of the different things that pictometry does. The big difference is, and you have to remember this, is if you was gonna do something with Google, you would have to pay them to make a layer for you. And it's not an internet-based. You need to buy a license, and then you still don't have anything, unless you want to look at photography. The main difference is, we're not going to sell or give Google our property lines. Okay, because when you give Google something, it's out there. Okay? And we feel our property lines is kind of like you guys' water line or whatever. You know, it's important to us. So you really can't do anything. And hopefully these two will agree, if you don't have the property lines under that photography, you don't have nothing. Because you don't know where you're at. You know where you're at, but if you want to do zoning at 200 foot radius, and you don't have property lines, 200 foot radius from where? I can measure, but I don't know where I'm measuring from, and I don't know where I'm supposed to stop. So the property lines, that's the important layer. And then you can add on top of that. So that's one big difference. If you look on there, Google has no IT people. They tried to call, they don't get anywhere over there. It's very tough. Now they can measure. Now when you go down to the, have you guys went down and did the satellite where you can walk down the street and look at the front views of all the buildings and so forth? Even in Google Pro, if you get down that low, because I tried it, you would think, oh, I'm gonna get good measurements now. You can't, all that goes off. You can't do anything from that point on. All you can do is look. Because that would have actually put them ahead of pictometry. But when they switched that, you can just walk down the street. And if you remember, on there you get a nice front photo, but you can't go to the sides and you can't go behind it. So that photo doesn't really help if your fire department or police department or cities want to use it, but with pictometry you can look around it and see what's going on. That was the biggest two things that we've seen, but, and I won't read them all, but I don't agree with all of them, but like the one, we're not doing this, and when you guys read through this, we're not doing this in our entity to gain revenue. Okay, as you guys know, I go out and do a lot of field checks anyway. We're not going to gain revenue from having this program like the big cities are, because they don't go find everything. So whenever you read that in there, that's not true here. So that wouldn't be the reason to do this. It's not going to pay for itself through new revenue, so to speak. So
on this pictometry, like a fire hydrant or a manhole or whatever, it's already got the location on there. Now, does Google have that capability or not? Or do you have to enter that on there?
Well, I think on Google Pro, they have it. And they think they have the longitude and latitude also, which would help you on your property stuff. You just won't have any property lines in to go with it. And then we can't, and I don't know if anybody in here has tried to be at home and tried to print off Google. It's kind of a task just to get it to print what's on your screen. I always get the top half, and then that's it. So printing would be a problem. We couldn't go Google Pro and print it off of our big plotter because you just can't do it. And Lane agreed over the morning that he hasn't had no excess printing on that.
You said that was after 3 years you'd go to basically $600 or something like that. So it's only a one-time fly deal, or is this a two-fly?
We can do a two-fly. The agreement with the county will say two flights. And of course it will cost later. A lot of times, you know, we would really probably have to see what's going on in the community. Like say 4 years from now we get wind farms or something, and you know, across the county, would that be a good time for the county to fly? Probably so, because we wouldn't have that photography on there. If something would happen in the city here and you need a new photography, that would be a good time. But typically what we've done is I'm not going to say I'm not going to use Google for updated flight. You know, I may use theirs every 2 years and then go back to our property lines and so forth like that. And maybe 6-7 years down the road, the county may want to fly again. And at that time is when you guys might want to go say, you know what, everybody in the county is using this. The younger generation's expecting it now. We got to think of that too. And then go to 3-inch. The county will never go to 3-inch. The 9-inch. 9-inch in the rule is very, very crystal clear. If you wanted me to pull one up in Saline County, it's really amazing how crystal clear it is at 9-inch.
So just because, say, something happened in the county and you had it flown again, doesn't mean we have to pay?
No.
As okay.
No, not at all.
Okay.
And I think those numbers that I gave you will be pretty accurate. I'm just saying that they're going to be pretty accurate. And it's going to be services to where you need something. You're not going to give a bill from the county every time you call us.
So other than just say we had a bunch of layers, we wouldn't get any additional bills from you guys.
And that's right. Okay. That's right. That's right. And you know, we have some others, like we have the city limits. You know, when we give that and it'd be on your website, that's a good time to review it. And then if there's an error, we can fix it and then send it off and have their IT people load it and do it.
Okay.
And then it'd be fixed for you guys. One thing we didn't talk about is if a disaster, which I know the last couple of years, tornado's been awful close to St. John. If something unfortunately would happen, pictometry will come out and fly that zone for us, free or minimal of charge, the zone where the tornado went through. And then what that would do then is when we came on here, we can do a split screen and we can do it for you guys. You can do it in your office. It would just help everybody that comes and helps. And if something would happen here in St. John, because it's a web-based site, you're not alone. We could go to Maxville, we could bring a laptop in, and we could go hook up to Pratt's printer, or we could hook up to Pawnee's printer, and we could make maps for whoever's coming in to help St. John. You're not sitting here. They're coming in and they're wanting all your information where everything is, and you can't get it. There's another advantage there. You're not hanging out there by yourself.
Well, that's kind of why I asked if it would have the addresses as well, in case of some type of disaster. Plus, for our mowing the lead ordinances, that's always a problem trying to find the right address. So.
I'm sure we're running into problems with it, but you know, like I said, I think. I don't know anybody. Russell County, they went out on their own. DMS director told me this 3 years ago, and they spent $150,000 on photography and didn't get pictometry. But they went out by themselves and did this. And I think we're getting a pretty good deal for all the cities and the county. So that's why I wanted to see how you guys felt. Like you said, if you don't want to join, there would be a cost anyway. Probably not, you know, the $1,500 for the first 3 years, but she couldn't look at nothing. You would, if you needed anything, you'd have to call.
Right.
Does anybody have any questions? That's kind of, well, I know the cost was one big thing. Yes, sir.
You may have already covered this and I missed it, but when you talk about printing, if we're going to use it, for instance, for a search warrant or something like that, and we just want a picture of the house, then if I have access to that, can I just print it for my office to get?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yep. And if you wanted to print the front, back, and however you wanted to look at it, and that's one thing that they were talking about. Slide already has this, and that's why I have it. But Slina comes over, you know, to Ellsworth County when they do a joint thing. And when they're driving over, they're telling the Ellsworth police what's theirs. And they're from Slina because they've already seen, they're using it in the vehicles. And they're seeing, you know, they can measure, they're telling them is behind the house there's two exits, but also 200 foot away, if there's a fence, it's not 4 foot, it's 10 foot. Which could make a difference for you guys, or where somebody could be hiding or something. So that's what's nice about it. They can use it, and if we want to let Great Bend or Pratt share, they can share with us when we need them to. If you see, you know, we're hoping the city of Great Bend participates.
You need us to mull this around tonight?
Well, you know, if I know you have to do whatever. We're going to take it into them the 15th just to see if they, you know, right as of the last time I talked to the commissioners, they were for it and they were going to do it, mostly because of the cost of what we needed to do. As you've seen on our photography here, it's 2006 aerial. We have to do something anyway. Otherwise, the maps we give the city, they're not real good anyway. So if we don't do nothing now, when are we going to do it? It's kind of where we're at. So if you guys talk about it, and then if she wants to call and just, or Mel wants to call and say, you know, we're talking about it, we think we're fine, and we would like to do it, that's fine with me.
Do you have any other cities on board currently?
I actually have a letter from Bo Stafford and Maxville. They actually, when they met, they actually wrote a letter and said, we want this, we're in. Don't leave us out. And actually at the time, I priced them higher than what I, at the time, and I've learned more, and it's actually cheaper for them than what they even thought.
So will they be drawing up a contract?
The county and Pictometry will draw up, it's about a 12-page contract, and how much they pay per year for 3 years. And then what we will do, because I talked to Jonathan, he's with Pictometry, is he said, don't draw up a contract with the cities, just give you like a predefined invoice of what you would have to pay and what you're going to get, and then have that with, excuse me, your budget for whatever it is. Actually, the commissioners in the, so far, nobody's going to relay this cost onto the taxpayers. They say for that amount, for the county even, for $11,000, $12,000 a year, they can pay that without messing the mill levy up. They would have the funds to do that. One thing that, and I'm not sure here, is if the police department would use this, some counties are using the drug money to pay for the whole thing. Because if the police department uses it, that's considered, you have to use it for something, don't you?
Counter drug or terrorist.
And so that entity then said, well, you know what, we use it all the time. We probably use it more than anybody. We'll just pay for it. But you know, and that would be with Jeff and the sheriff too, you know. But they would have to use it. The city has to use it. We have to use it. Or it's we wasted our time. So, you know, we probably work together quite a bit then maybe on some of them.
I have another question. When you talk about property lines, does that mean a private citizen could get their property lines without having to pay a surveyor $500?
That's a good question. Actually, you can do that right now. The only thing is for tax entities, we're not a surveyor. We can get you close if you want. Like, you know, say we know the street's 100-foot road right away, and you find the center of the street 50-foot, and then you go your property lines. You know, that can get you close. If, like, we have a dispute in Hudson right now because we do zoning in Hudson. And for property lines, if it's a dispute between two property owners, our records probably aren't close enough for a property dispute. They would need to go get a survey. Yeah. Now, that's a good question. But for normal, everyday things, probably for zoning, I think it works pretty good until it gets down to, that's my property line 1 foot over here. If they have a problem, now they need to get a survey.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Carl.
Thank you.
There is a fairly low flow hydrant also, so I cannot guarantee you if we switch this line out that we might not have a complaint because it's hooked up to a polar line. These are the ongoing, you know, if we hadn't flushed today, probably within a couple of days, I'd have gotten a complaint from Mary's Kitchen or Mary's Beauty or Mr. Massey. So they're the most common ones that are affected by this or whatever.
If you take a sample on 3rd Street, it's clear.
You mean north up there? Yeah. We haven't had any complaints up there, but we flush hydrant. We always get the hydrant lead, you know, from the main to the hydrant, it sits in there, you know, all the time. And whenever we flush hydrants, there's always some discolored water there. We'll get out the main. Most generally, it clears up there real quick. And we have some other areas in town that we've had some problems with, but this, they've gone away and this hasn't. So I've talked to the engineers and they gave me there's their probable cost on doing that project. I priced it myself on us doing the buying the materials and having it bored and us doing the work. That's $115,000, and that includes engineering, inspection, and everything.
What was your bill when you came up?
$35,000 would probably take care of it. I want my little padding in there just in case, because whenever you be digging, you're always, that's what change orders are for, you know, when you have a contractor do it. So, I would think we could probably do it for $35,000 plus, just to be safe. What everyone would need to understand is, you know, with us doing this, we went through up there on 6th Street. We always get interrupted. You know, sometimes we can. We have all the intentions we're going to spend all day on the water line, or we've got a sewer problem, or we've got another water leak, or something like that. We just cannot spend, don't have enough people to stay on it, get it done as fast as some people might think. We're going to have, you know, a road tour for some time.
You know, I would think on Main Street, may want to find a contractor that could, like you could do a tie and, you know, cut it down to a 1 week deal at least.
Well, the ties themselves, you know, getting the we're going to have to, you know, open up the street for the bore and get all that in and make the connections. And what I would foresee if we were going to do it, of course, we're running into, you know, what's the weather going to do? Is it, you know, it could get bad on us. Unexpectedly. We're still trying to finish up on some street work, getting ready for sealing and do that. But if we could get the new line board put in, connections made at the end, and not abandon the old line, not put in the fire hydrant, and then switch the people that have the habitual problems with the rusty water, get them on a new line, and then we could still, you know, if we got the line in, got the three people switched over, and it turned winter, or if we had so much other stuff we couldn't get to it, we would hopefully have those people, you know, taken care of. And we could, as time permit, get a day, we would switch them over and do it that way. So it'd just be whatever you wanted to do. As far as paying for this, talked to John, we've got the CIP fee, you know, collect every month off people's bill, and there's money in there to at least cover, if we would do it, I don't know if there's enough there to be the contractor or the partner.
Well, for savings of almost $80,000, I'd say we could.
Same here.
Would be my personal opinion. I mean, there it's $115,000.
So, Mel, does that, if you don't do the fire hydrant now, you will do it later, though?
Exactly. Okay. I mean, our intent would be to do it all, but I'm just saying, worst sure. case scenario, you know, we have to open up the road, get a board in, make the connections, and switch it over, and then once we would have to be in a position to abandon the line to you know, change out the fire hydrant, put it on the, we cut in the valve and the T and everything for it, and get everybody switched over, then we could abandon the fire hydrant, put the fire hydrant on the last. You could put it in if you had more room on that corner, but there's not much room there to, you know, to set one way or the other. It really about needs to be where it's at. You know, like I said, but just we've got other places in town, and I don't know, it's just because of the age of the pipes. Like I said, I've talked to Kansas River Water, I've talked to our engineers at Wayne, and usually, normally, you can clear this up with a routine flushing. And so there's something going on with that pipe that, a lot of people are blaming it on a nitrate plant, but, all of you just take the nitrates out. So it's just, you can get the line, get pigged, which is basically you can clean it out. You know, that's $15 a foot to do that. But you've still got a 4-inch line when you're done. That's a 4-inch line. We're going to upgrade to a 6-inch. So even if you got the line cleaned out, I'm not saying it wouldn't come back, but you still got a 4-inch line in. It's got a 6-inch on the north and a 6-inch on the center. So the one on the north there is 2nd Street by the lumber yard. That's a 6-inch line that was put in during the water project in 1996. The one in the south is a 6-inch cast iron. I don't really know the age on it. It's really tall. So hopefully this will take care of it. If nothing else, be an improvement in get a fire hydrant to put out some flow. Like I said, I don't want to come back to, well, you still got some complaints. Hopefully not. We've got cast iron water lines, and it can happen. We may pull something in. It's be a two-pronged deal that would hopefully take care of the discolored water. I got a sample of the water if you want to see it from this afternoon. It's just discolored. It's not as strong as tea, but it's discolored. We've kind of gotten away from the sediment. Used to get a lot of heavier particles that would settle out fairly quickly. But now it's mostly just a discolored water. It cleans up fairly quickly.
So do we have to make a motion for that? I'd make a motion to have Bullet Mill fix the water line on Main Street. I'm doing it ourselves. You're saying 30, if we say max not to go above 40,
yeah.
Not to go above 40,000.
Is that covering all the pipe connections?
Yes, everything.
New hydrant and everything.
To be paid for out of the...
Oh, to be paid out of the... Of what fund?
Capital improvement water.
To be paid out of capital.
As long as we've got all the pipe to fit in, new fire hydrant, everything figured in that. Is that about right?
Yes, sir.
Boring.
It's 27,000.
Everything except the label.
Boring is 27,000.
That's giving me 4,000.
Yeah, I get the best.
What's your 35? 30, basically 35.
Yeah.
Or 30,500.
Did I get 9,000?
That's your estimate.
Yeah, and then a 5 and then plus. So if we go 40, that'll be, because I've estimated on the road repair. So that's something that's kind of hard to figure on how much we're going to tear out.
Any further? Yeah, I got you. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
I know. We're the engineers. Yes. Next item is street sealing. There's a map of what slurry sealing for this year. The company that has done it for us for a number of years, they are really heavily booked this year, and we usually are at the last part of September and October. They've had some bad weather and they're really heavily booked, so they're looking at probably the last part of the month to do that. Somebody may be worried about temperature and everything, but as long as the road surface is 44 degrees and rising, they can still do the work. like I said, we've got quite a bit we need to get going on to get ready for that to come. So we're going to kind of be an overlap here on the water field, slurry seal preparation that we need to do at the quarter. So as far as the money part of it, okay, we're looking at about 31 blocks roughly, and it's all a square yard, so there's a way we pay for this. So some streets are narrower or wider than others, so it's going to, you know, vary as far as how far this would normally go. But we're looking at 41,660 square yards, and so it'd be, that dirt price they gave us this year would be $92,485.20. Last year, just for information, we did a little over about 36,000 square yards and spent almost 77,000. So they wouldn't make sense of square yard on the price. Like John and I worked together and got the money to cover it. So.
Terrible if we just skipped it this year.
Well, you're just going to go backwards. I mean, if you lose the road, you know, just, I know you probably all saw that strip we did down there in front of the co-op down there on First Street down there. I don't know if you saw that strip we had tore up. You know, just the mat alone is where we dug up and replaced that. That was $6,000. You can imagine what it would cost to do a whole block. So this, we need to save the roads. We've gone to a lot of areas now. Instead of, you know, a road that's completely bad, we're trying to save it naturally, but we're doing a lot more shoulder work, and we're going to need to do more shoulder work when we'll saw it and tear out, replace the shoulder, and seal it back. And a lot of times the shoulder is what ends up going. A lot of us, actually, because it doesn't get gripped on it. We have a lot of wide roads that traffic helps us and keeps it good.
Yeah. Are they using sand or chat or what?
It's got Joplin chat in it. It's kind of like a hard flint-like stuff. And there's sand in it. There's concrete in it. There's oil. It's the same deal they've been doing for years. For us, so.
Well, I didn't know what the difference between that and like what the county does. What's the difference?
Quite a bit of difference as far as you know, they use their from the pit out there. They use it. And this is a like I say, it's got Portland cement on it. But it's not just, it's different than what they do. We used to have the county do it years ago, and one of the reasons that we switched is, you know, when they put it down, they have to put enough extra aggregate on top of it, sand, to keep it from picking up and bleeding, and all the excess we have to go over and with our street sweeper pick all that up. You know, out of the county, it just blows off of the grader ditch most generally, but in town, we can't leave it on the road, and it just trashes the street sweeper in fairly short order. I mean, it was just, it's just like probably one of the hardest things that they really aren't even designed to do that. I mean, you know, we've got our sweeper, we wore out, nursed it along, and we got this new one, and it's, you know, it's without doing that part of it. So you got to figure your sweeper paint in what you pay for this. Plus, everything you put down, basically, I mean, you get a little bit of sloughing off or a little bit of stuff like when we grade or something like that in the winter time, but basically everything you pay for pound wise you put on the road stays there. But the county, you know, it's on there, you pay for it, and then you sweep up the excess and then you stockpile it. Not that you can't use it somewhere else, but we weighed all this out years ago, and it's, you know, like everything else, it's getting more and more expensive all the time. But the alternative, if we don't do anything, it's really expensive. Unless the city would want to go to some kind of a bond deal on a big street deal and go to hot mix or concrete or something like that, you know, it's about before kind of.
How much cheaper? Just how much cheaper would it be to just do like mechanic compared to that?
It's been years since I've priced it. I will say that if you're going to buy a street sweeper, I don't know how long would. We finally got the street sweeper paid off, but how many years did it take? And said you will never, probably ever, get out and make a street sweeper. Ever. have that thing wore out and buy a new one.
And there's no really, with this product, there's no city man hours involved.
We get a little bit cheaper price because we load their trucks for them. And we do some pre-sweeping.
I mean, afterwards.
Right. I mean, we spend weeks picking up.
Before.
Getting that other picked up. Yeah. It's Stafford for years, they were doing very little, and now they switched over to Inman. I mean, they Wichita. This is kind of the county does it because, yes, it's less expensive. It works
fast
for them out there. In the city, it's really nice because if you don't have the dust, you don't have the everything. There's just a lot of pluses. I mean, next year, I mean, we're pretty, they're done sealing now. So, I mean, if you want me to get prices next year, I can, but there's just a lot of downside to it. I mean, that's why we switched.
Do I hear a motion to approve the $92,485 street repairs? Ceiling, 20 cents.
Well, we sure don't want the streets to look like that. We've got to do something.
Is that a motion? All motions. Do I hear a second?
Bob, did you move that?
Yes.
Don't want to put words in your mouth, right?
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? I don't.
Okay, we do need to add in where that's been made out of. So Val and I will work together so that I can get it in the motion. Is that all right for you guys? It's all encumbered and was budgeted for this, so general fund and special highway.
So I would agree with Troy. I'd like to see what they cost here.
I can remember back in the day when they did that nice little gray chat.
I did too.
But they still had a little cleanup today.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure that's a lot more expensive.
Any other reports, Mel? Oh, the gentleman did ask that next year to maybe just check on the county helping us once. See what the price difference is next year. Anything else?
No, I think we're covered on the Scout Cabin and
okay, that's all I have. Fire department is absent. Police department. Or does anybody have any questions for Mel?
Adam, by the way,
any questions for Adam? Administration, Joanna.
Yeah, my estimates did come in, so we don't have anything there. I will say that we've gotten a couple of copies of the code. We've been working on the code and having that recodified, so I will be sending you an email if you want to go, or a website if you want to go out and look at that. And I have two hard copies in here as well. So something we'll want to go over here in the next meeting or two as well.
Any questions for Donna? Electric department, please. City attorney position, John Stoll, or no, John Beverland from Stoll and Beverland, LLC, practicing.
Well, I guess I can introduce myself again. I am John Beverland. I'm a partner with Stoll and Beverland of Pratt. We were contacted this morning by Jonna, and I guess one thing led to another, and I thought I'd come and check out a meeting. But I see that she has included a copy of my, I guess, a bio, and I will put a kind of an asterisk on it. I was surprised to see that myself, because we're in the middle of redoing our website, and was not aware that this had been added. So I have not. It looks accurate, so I have not exactly perused that. I've noticed that our phone number is actually incorrect So there's some problems. We have to website about once every 2 years. For whatever reason, this went up before approval. We do see attorney stuff for a number of cities, Greensburg being the largest. We do city work for Isabel in Barber County, for Sawyer in Pratt County, Preston in Pratt County. Greensburg has a police department. They do only have one officer though, so we do municipal court, nuisance prosecutions, speeding tickets, traffic offenses, and that kind of thing, which I mainly handle. If you are seeking and want to retain our office, you're probably retaining the office, not just myself. I do assistant city work for Greensburg. I cover the municipal court stuff. I'd anticipate that I'd do both here, and then my partner Gordon, who's been doing city attorney stuff for about 30 years, would fill in when I'm not available. I guess if you guys have any questions for me, I know it's by surprise for most of you that I'd be here.
And let me just tell you how that came about a little bit. So when I talked to the mayor the other day, she asked me if we could contact the league to see if they could assist us in a nuisance ordinance. And after I spoke with the league, they didn't feel like that was their place, and found out also that unless we chartered out of a certain statute, that the attorney that we would use needed to reside in the county of which they were representing or the neighboring county. So that kind of made me feel like that instead of putting ads out and stuff, I needed to be checking to see who other cities close by used. And I thought about the city clerks that I know, and the first one I called was Greensburg, and she gave me the information. I called the mayor, and the mayor asked me to go ahead and contact their firm, and that's what brought us to this point.
Okay, I guess I've got a quick question. Do you work on a retainer? Is it so much an hour?
It's strictly an hourly basis. If the city wants me at every city council meeting, we do that for Greensburg. Starting to do a little more for some cities, not for others. And that hourly rate is $150. Okay, that's charged, includes travel time from our office in Pratt to Sawyer, and then usually there's office time, so if you want me to draft warrants or review an ordinance. I'm coming into this completely blind. I don't know what ordinances you guys have, whether you've adopted the model offense code that is drafted by the League of Kansas Municipalities every year. There's going to be some time to bring me up to speed on those type of issues. But it's specifically hourly and however you guys want to use me. And I don't really know how you've typically used a city attorney in the past. So we do run a diversion program in Greensburg, through the municipal board there, which does raise diversion fee funds and stuff, which are then used by the police department there. So it is somewhat fee generating. There's court costs then and everything that are charged to support the municipal board.
Okay. Do you have a minimum for a phone call, or
is
that structured?
To be honest, I think our software runs on a 5 minute program.
5 minutes.
Yeah, when I talked to Gordon today, he said it's like a 12th of an hour. So he said 5 minutes.
Yeah, it's. I record my time, and my bookkeeper enters that time when I believe it's a 5 minute difference.
So you can put us together a list of your charges. Like phone call from just what you told us there, an hourly rate to get the meeting, and we can put it on the 21st meeting. And then we would also maybe even ask, can we go ahead and use you now? Since we have something.
Yeah, you would probably need to make a motion to hire.
Yeah.
Before you would.
Should be some city ordinance require a resolution. That resolution is adopted every year. I really don't know how you guys.
The mayor usually appoints.
Okay.
our attorney, and then they would approve her appointment.
We don't have anything right now that we need an attorney, do we?
Yeah,
yes,
we do.
Yeah.
Okay. We have lots of them. They've been handy to have an attorney.
Yeah. Well, and what I can do is I can put together a letter for the city for the 21st, just so you guys can approve the financial side. Huh?
Yeah.
I guess I'll make a motion. Driver, stolen beggar.
Beverly.
You're not hired yet, but how do we do that?
Well, I'm assuming somebody's filling in.
Yes.
Okay. I think you can make a temporary appointment and approve it by motion of the council.
Oh, that's better. Yeah. What's the track line?
Okay, so this is off the books. You need to make an appointment, and then they would need to approve your appointment.
Okay, my appointment would be to appoint John.
Yes.
Yeah, John Beverly, of Stolen Beverly, of Pratt, at their $150 an hour rate. And I would ask for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second. Control, any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hello.
Congratulations.
Public nuisance ordinance.
I'm going to bring the speed of you.
Just the stuff in here.
Yeah.
This is something else.
Basically, the mayor had asked me to, there came out some questions about the reference to the old Methodist church over here, some parties that were going on, reference public intoxication. There was a report that somebody had urinated somewhere. We're not sure whether it happened in a yard or any alley or whatever. Kansas is not a state that has public intoxication laws, and typically indecency community kind of crime things are dealt with ordinance as far as urinating in public or that kind of thing. I mean, I think you could go a far stretch and charge that as a disorderly conduct kind of thing, but again, it's a misdemeanor crime, not something that was actually caught by law enforcement. So, and when I communicated that to her, she felt it was necessary that we maybe add some ordinances to help cover some of those quality of life kind of issues. Typically, I would go through the KACP and search out some ordinances and stuff like that. and I was slow getting some responses to that. So the resource I use is called IACP.net. And as an International Association of Chiefs of Police member, that's one of the benefits to that. This IACP.net is basically a clearinghouse of hundreds upon thousands of policies, documents, and that kind of thing. I wasn't able to find any in the state of Kansas, but the ones I researched all were pretty well generic kind of things, just basically stating that it is unlawful to urinate in public, to be intoxicated, and that kind of thing.
So, John, at this time, our nuisance ordinances doesn't really address this.
Okay.
It addresses the weeds and that sort of thing. But it doesn't really go into, I guess, behavioral things. Loud car, you know, music and that sure. sort of thing. It doesn't list anything like that specifically.
One of the kind of the examples of a hole, I guess, in state law is if anybody's in the news in Topeka, they're having problems with mentally handicapped homeless people walking up the streets of Topeka naked. And unless they are doing so in a manner to elicit pleasure or cause pleasure, it's not illegal. And the city is having trouble controlling that. Some of the homeless people have wandered close to elementary schools. But I guess the city just needs a direct time to draft an ordinance for the city's adoption. Probably stick to the same kind of fine schedule you have now. I have to look at that.
Sounds good to me.
You know, there's specific things that you want. I mean, obviously we've covered the same thing over and over right here.
And it's zoned R1 now.
That's the next thing. But I mean, this would be overall city-wise. Do you want to address noise? Because this doesn't.
We've already got a code for noise, though.
We do.
As far as I know.
Okay.
Because
I was kind of looking for it.
It's a disturbing piece.
Yeah.
Loud noise.
Yeah.
Loud noise, and it's pretty vague. It basically says if we think it's too loud, then it's too loud. And typically the rule of thumb we use, if we get a loud music play or something like that, if we drive up to the house with our windows down, we can hear it on the street, then common sense would say the person next door can hear it as well, and so we ask them to turn it down.
And that's basically because we adopted the UPC, right?
UPOC.
Or UPOC.
No, this part's actually in our city code.
The UPOC does not include public intoxication.
UPOC doesn't know. Otherwise, it wouldn't be. That would be fine. And I think a lot of it is because if they were out drinking in the street, then that is illegal because you're on the street drinking. But however, I don't think that covers the alleys. And again, it just doesn't cover that fine line of whether or not somebody being obnoxiously intoxicated is
on private property
is disorderly conduct. Because if they're not offending somebody or being rude or something like that, then you don't have disorderly conduct.
And the only thing, just kind of looking at this first one where it says, or any place open to the public, I kind of have to look at that. My concern is, would that include a bathroom window? Somebody has a bathroom window open, they can go over using the restroom. I'll drive something. Some options, I guess, for the city to consider.
Okay. That'd be great. Okay, correspondence regarding property use in R1 area.
That was our next set of stapled information. Okay.
Mayor asked that this be put into your packets so that you can see all the correspondence that she and I have both got regarding.
But is it in our, it is on this residential.
If I could just kind of elaborate.
Yep.
He had come back when he opened up the bounty hunting facility over there. He applied and that was changed. Okay. When,
on the old zone.
On the old zoning, he changed it to C1.
Okay.
When we redid the zoning in 2011, was that right? Okay. That area was changed to R1. He had ceased to operate as a business at that point. We would have utilities off, and he didn't operate as a business at that time. So had it still be going, had a business going on, even though we changed the ordinance, or zoning rather, he could have had a legal non-conforming use in that area, even though we zoned it R1. He still could have operated the bounty hunter facility there and still been okay. But he ceased to operate, and so it is now R1. I visited with him about that. He came in the office. John was there, and he's contending that he doesn't agree with that. So
he actually felt like we should have personally
notified him
that it was going to change. We did go through all the proper procedures of our hearings, our public hearings, and in any kind of publications that we needed to make to do the zoning, the revamping the zoning. So in that respect, it was okay, and you know, the property owner should be responsible for paying attention to what's going on where he owns property. But he's not agreeing with that. He felt like he should have gotten a personal letter. So.
And I did check with Bigley Foster, you know, our zoning consultant on that, as far as, and he's had some history on specific, you know, similar things, and he says that we followed all the proper procedures and everything, so he's confident we're okay in that regard. So if he wants to operate his, or start this business up officially and legally, he needs to make an application to the Planning Commission for a special use. Okay.
And then we have to approve it or whatever.
Yeah, it would go before them and it would come before the council a bit. But just for similar, it would be like when Marshall started his tire business. That's in a residential area. We did not change the zoning. We gave him special use with conditions. So if he were to do that, he would go before the board and they would review it, make recommendations, so it could be done with restrictions as they saw fit through all of it. I think the final would go before you all to approve that. So he doesn't agree with that either, so
it's tough.
Well, and with the special zoning, when they are able to put any kind of restrictions on, you know, as far as time or noise or whatever they want to. Just like with Marshall, you couldn't use certain equipment after a certain time, so it would disrupt the neighborhood. People know there'll be a hearing, and so they'll have their option to be able to.
He had already had one
get-together.
Get-together, there you go, thank you. Already had one get-together for this, you know, that we had to complain about, and when we had visited with him in regard to what he would have to do, he said he had already had something planned for the next weekend for do something else, and we said, well, that's, you know, would be against our zoning regulations. So anyway, but he did not end up having anything. So,
and a special use permit is specific to that owner for that use. Anytime that he would change the use, would have to get another special use permit for whatever he would want to change it to. Or if he would sell it and somebody wanted to do the same thing, they would have to apply for that. So it's not like if you give it to him, it could be handed over to somebody else, or you know, it could be changed to whatever he wanted to. It is specific to that use for that person.
is that that's the beauty of that versus changing the zoning, which is
and having spot zoning.
Spot zoning around. We have occasions that where it came up, so this is a lot cleaner. Sells property, moves away, shuts down, whatever, it's still more residential.
Any other comments?
Yeah. Don't we have a situation with some electricity or water or something? Adam, didn't we have some something with electricity?
That was at
some other street or town or something or property.
That was another property he owns on Second Street.
Was, correct me if I'm wrong, stealing electricity. What? Where are we at on that?
There's no. That was one of the very convenient things that he was gone, supposedly gone. I don't have any way to prove or deny it, but he was gone when that happened. And before it was actually found out that the electricity was stolen, he actually reported a burglary at his house, at that same house. So I have my suspicions as to what happened, but as far as actually being able to prove it, I'm at a standstill on that.
I'd heard something about it, and then I never heard no more about it. Yeah.
We can't do nothing about it anyways until the zoning board.
That's right. Yeah, I mean,
so
at this point.
If he applies.
Yeah.
Right.
If he comes.
I mean,
at this point, it's
officially,
in Adam's hands, right?
He can't do it anyway, right?
Correct.
Okay.
So what happens if he does? He gets a ticket?
Yeah. It's, well, we looked it up in our. He would be in violation.
Fine. I think it is a fine of up to $500 for each day.
And shut down at that point, or are they allowed to go ahead and continue all that?
My question.
Until it comes before the judge, I guess. Yeah,
that'd be a good question for the attorney if it's shut down.
If it's something that he does repetitively, you could ask that you could even, the city could even sue a district court and ask for an injunction. And then if he does it now, he's in violation of, you know, of district court. The judge isn't going to stand. The other thing is you can amend your ordinance, increase the fine. $500 may be considered cost of doing business. $1,000 may start to hit the pocketbook.
Okay.
Why would we have any more, do one ordinance? Do we want to have them look at
another? Yeah,
we
should.
It may be, and I don't know, maybe the ordinance says that each new day is a big fine.
It's per
day.
Per day, per occurrence.
But do we need to even have an ordinance, or is this going to take care of itself?
We'll see. I mean, that's kind of where we're at. Is he knows what our zoning is, and he knows what we've given him the information. So it's pretty much in his hands.
So right now he's effectively shut down. He can't.
He cannot rent his building to anyone for a private party.
Okay. I think we should fit John with a public ordinance book if we have an extra copy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Probably with a code book.
That's what I meant.
Okay, property auction guidelines. We need the public auction, whether we do it as is, refuse all bids.
Just to start this out, I did find the mayor had wanted us to get some prices or bids on what it cost to get that auction off. I did contact John Hamm on Hamm Auction and Pratt, told him what we were going to do. If we'll take care of the advertisement, the insuring of the property and everything, he said he would come up, an auction off for $250. They charge 5%. Can't beat that. So it's very good. So I told him here, I said that's the only part. So I think that's what we'll do with. So now have whatever, and I'm glad that John's here so he can kind of
might want to catch
yeah.
you up a little bit.
We have a property that the city became in possession with. The mortgage company basically gave it to the city, needs a new roof. And they gave us some money toward repairing the roof. We're going to put a new roof on it and then auction the property off. And the purpose of it
we wanted to protect it from someone buying it and tearing it down. We wanted someone to live in. So the question is, or I guess what we want to do is put restrictions on the auction. In other words, we're going to sell it to you, but we don't want it tore down. Can we do that?
Or
do we have to be, you know, own it for so many years? I mean, we want the house to stay there. We don't want somebody to buy it for a, you know, the city's not out to make a lot of money. We want to recover our costs, and we'd rather not somebody just buy it and say, well, I'm going to tear it down. So that's what we want to do.
And has there been a consideration of doing like a minimum?
Correct.
Okay. So he starts the auction at whatever, but it doesn't sell until it's reached.
We were going to start it out at a minimum. We want to at least get our money back for the roof repair and any other advertisement or anything else. We're not wanting it to sell for $50,000 necessarily. We want it to sell low enough someone can get into it and make repairs. So that's what we want to do.
You know, to be honest, I'd have to look to see whether you guys really can be a stipulation. The question that comes to my mind is how do you know how do you release it? We're assuming the bank has deeded over the property to the city. The city's going to have to deed the property over to the buyer. And then what control, I don't know what control thing the city can then have over that individual buyer.
I think it would be very difficult.
Yeah.
I think you can put the minimum on, which everybody does at most auctions. This is what I have to have.
At least then the person is serious about buying and doing something with it. A minimum higher than the value of the lot.
Oh.
Because then it kind of gives them incentive not to just tear it down for the lot. I guess I don't know what the property is, whether the lot would be valuable.
Right. My opinion was just the minimum of what we have invested.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Just so we didn't have it
there. The impression.
That's what we were talking about earlier, yeah. But that was if we could kind of put a stipulation on that it couldn't be torn down.
That would be tough.
Because we have had some internet bidders at times too, and so then the house sits there and it dilapidates again.
Yeah. And then.
Never goes on a tax roll.
Yeah, and then, I mean, that's the county's experience that when they do tax sales, usually. We did county council work for Pratt for a long time, and usually the county would auction it off the Malhorn. Okay? And the problem is somebody buys it, and then all of a sudden they're racking up weed fees and mowing fees because they're not doing anything with the property, and then it gets auctioned again. I'd have to think about that.
What we're trying to do is keep a water, the lights, the gas, place for somebody to come and move in.
And, I mean, it's once it has a roof on it, it can be livable while they do the renovation.
But if we set our minimum high enough, somebody surely wouldn't buy it, just tear it down.
That's the other side of it. Right. You know, we were trying to keep it low enough so somebody could afford to buy it, but if you get it too low, I can pay that, tear it down, and be happy.
Well, you know, if you set a minimum like $5,000, you might have a landlord buy it, fix it up for a tenant, use it as an investment property. I don't know what it's appraised at.
Do you like John to research it for a day and have him contact John or Mel, or you?
Well, we're really not ready to advertise that yet, so I mean, they haven't started the roof. We're not in
the roof's going to cost $9,200, correct?
No, it's 74.
Something like that.
Yeah.
We're going to have $2,500 going in.
So we're not
going
to have much in it other than some. The electric department's been cutting down the trees and, you know, mowed it once. So it's, we're not going to have a lot in it. But, so that may be kind of a detriment if we get it too low. Because somebody could still want to tear it down. So that's what we want to accomplish somehow.
So go ahead and direct him to spend an hour on it, or two, or whatever the research, the guideline.
Yeah. Yeah. You're just going to have to add it to the price of the house.
Yeah.
No pressure.
You just come up with a yes or no answer.
The minimum.
You know what I mean?
I don't care. You can have any research.
Yeah. That's fine.
Whatever his bill is, we'll just add it to the minimum on the house.
That's consensus, John. Do we need a motion to make Ham Auction the auction company? No.
Did you get an actual bid?
No. They're going to give it to us in writing.
Let's wait until we get it in writing.
Thank you. Request to block off a street for a wedding dance on November 4th, is that right?
October 18th.
It's been there for 6 in the morning. From the alley west, it's been done.
I'm against the alley.
No, it's from the alley west.
Oh, from the
west
alley.
Side of the alley. Yeah.
Well, did you guys have some issues last time with people driving around barricades or something like that? Was that because the whole street wasn't blocked off, or do you know?
I don't know. Just because people wanted to drive around them, I guess.
Okay. I was just trying to figure out, a way to make sure that we could do it to try to discourage people from doing that.
Adam, I don't think you're probably going to. Okay. If they're going to drive around them, they'll drive on the curb. It's St. John.
Well, I understand that, but at the same time, you know, if we can keep people from driving on some of the
But I think might have been some of we had them spaced apart, too far apart.
Okay.
No, I didn't think it would be here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay. Okay, I hear motion.
Saturday, October 18th, from 6 p.m. to 1 a.m. From the alley behind the post office to the corner of Exchange. On my first street.
Now your second.
I'm going to refrain from voting possibility of conflict here.
All those things. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed. So, and can we point Mel or one of your guys on that Friday evening to lay out 4 barricades?
They want to come get them?
Yeah.
We can take them over there.
Right. We would put that on them. Meeting at training November 4th, regular meeting. Everybody give that.
That's just an FYI, but the guy from the league.
He's coming from another meeting in Wichita.
Yeah, he's doing the City Clerks Institute in Wichita, and we'll be there until 5, so he'll come from there to here and do training here. Then I don't know if he has to go back to Wichita or back to Topeka, but he said if we would just, we could do it right in the meeting, and that way it's, you know, videoed and the whole works, so.
Comments on that? Solid waste charges. Somebody had discussed maybe having the commercial trash be between Stafford County Trash Service and the customer, and the city would be out of that.
Mm-hmm.
And we would stay billing the residential trash. That's one option. I don't know of any other options.
Can we even do anything while the contract, or do we have to wait until the contract is to be renewed?
I'm sure you can come to an agreement if this trash service wants to do that to help the people that don't have trash there. They can work it out between them instead of 3 parties.
If we're going to go by the contract as it is, then we're supposed to be billing everybody for everything.
Well,
so if he wants to do it any differently, which he has indicated he does, then if we could change that contract and the city just bill for residential, and then he can do whatever he wants to with his commercial accounts. It would be, it would simplify things in here because the communication, you know, it doesn't always happen the way that you would expect it to, and so, and changing the system for every change that might take place with whomever he's visiting with, you know, which is, they already bill for the rule, so I don't think it's a big stretch. When I got on the city clerk's listserv and brought that information to you last week, that was the only other option that was out there, other than this is the contract, this is what we do. Some of their contracts did, I think there was three of them that said they just billed for the residential and the company, the trash company, billed their own commercial. So, I mean, that's an option that I think that others have done, and it must be working fine. If you wanted to.
I thought part of the problem was, though, people that have commercial and was using their commercial dumpster and still getting charged residential. That's not going to cure anything.
You sure it is. Because if he wants to not charge as much commercial because he's picking up he's charging the residential, that's up for him. That's up to him. But they would still pay their residential bill.
The only negotiating we had was vacant property from storage only that didn't produce trash, but had a commercial rate being billed. Have you discussed it with the Stafford County Trash Service?
No. We needed to make a decision here.
Right. We need to make a decision to have her discuss it. Make sure Terry wants to change the contract.
See if he would be interested in doing it that way. Is that
consensus?
Maybe he'd rather just take the whole thing over.
Well, that'd be great.
Residential and commercial.
Just fill it up.
No.
Yeah.
That would be the way to do that.
Would you like her to approach it both ways?
That would be awesome. We could just get out of the trash bin.
You can approach it
both
ways. Okay. Mel has had an inquiry about rebuilding the scout cabin, and I looked at it from a contractor's point of view. Talked to Nick Lauper. There's only one exit right now. The door opens in. And there is a framed hole back in the corner for another door. We talked, if you're going to make it more public, both doors need to open out. It's going to take two new doors, possibly all new steel siding, and all electric heating and air.
Did we actually figure out who owns it and
we
all
do
of a sudden?
And there is some insulation in the walls. There's none in the ceiling. So we talked, you know, like Nick had looked at it or whatever we talked about. One of the costs was to resheet that inside there. And so there is evidence of some insulation in the walls. But I climbed up in the, looked up in the attic and there's zero up there. So that's if you're going to do any heating or cooling.
There is money to do all this, right?
Last time, wasn't Cornwell Park?
Yeah, that would be.
Well, that was one option.
That was an option.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
There has not been a mention made to use the Cornwell
Park. Okay.
As far as budgeting is what I'm sharing.
Okay.
What happened to when the Boy Scouts approached us and they were going to have it done? They were going to do it through community effort and volunteers. What happened to this?
They still talked about doing some fundraising, but they talked to Nick about them doing the work.
I thought they approached us about them doing the work if we would allow that to happen. And then it just kind of went.
For some reason, I had some kind of a figure somebody brought to us as like $4,500.
Nick had done some preliminary work. He had some figures he had worked up before. Some time back, and I think maybe some of the thought process of what needed to be done has changed a little bit. I think one of the thoughts was, going back with maybe wood siding, keeping the the log cabin look, and, but for maintenance and longevity, it'd probably go with some kind of a colored steel. It's got a, I mean, it's got a good roof on it. I mean, it's the best thing it's got going for it. So, but you know, these other changes, if it's going to be used, I mean, these are all things Kevin's looked at, and I would agree if we're going to do anything with it.
It has a functioning restroom. If there was heat in there year round.
Well, if it belongs to the city, I think, and it is a scout cabin, I think we better get it up where they can use it. I noticed Mitch Menace had a comment in the file there, wanting to know who owned it.
Right, and that's what, you know, Nick Loffer, before he worked for the city, had, and with the scouts and all that, that's where it kind of started, and it kind of waned off. And Mitch talked to me about it, and I talked to Nick, and so that's kind of where we're kind of full circle. It just kind of went kind of by the wayside for a little bit, or lost momentum, might be the better word for it. Did you end up talking to the school at all about any, you know, because the school does use it?
Yeah. If they get a rainy track meet or something up there, I mean, they use it
a lot. Every football game.
Yeah. Every football game.
Like I said, it's, as far as the city functionality of it, we don't use it. We have it available to whoever does have a use for it. And I know, because I think the scouts are meeting, I don't know if it's Weeblos or somebody's using it right now, but as the weather gets colder, you know, that'll have to stop. So there's a demand for the use of it. So I guess.
Yeah, you would make a consensus to have John and Mel make sure there's funds available, and then have Mel go get bids for the repairs.
I'd be in favor of the repair. Get it working. Get the bathroom working, get heat and air in it.
Kevin, would you be able to help with the specifications on this as far as what you looked at?
Yeah. Okay. And I'll go ahead and get the two bids for siding or doors. One guy can do that. Two bids for your HVAC, and then the plumbing is probably okay. I don't remember the last time I was a kid it ever worked. I know what I wanted it to work.
Maybe it's not hooked up.
Oh yeah.
Is it?
Yes, it is.
But we just got a fairly decent electric service. I didn't take the covers off, but
yeah, I didn't.
I didn't mention this earlier, and I think I need to. Because of the, on the solid waste contract, because there was an increase, we're going to have to amend our budget for that, and I'll have to put that in the paper too, for the hearing and so forth. If we don't make a change and we continue to do what we're doing right now, I will have to amend 2015's as well. But if we do make a change, there's probably plenty better to. It's not a big deal. We just have to go through the process. But it's time to do that. We don't want to wait too long because it's lengthy, because it has to go through the waiting periods just like our regular budget does.
Okay. Everybody good with that consensus?
Yeah, if we're going to hire any contractors, I'd like for these local contractors.
Motions to adjourn.
Yep.
Second.
Any further discussion? Nope. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.